It's time for the birth of the new golden era. Welcome to Shattering the Matrix. Your host, Ari Kopel, and co-host Serena bring you information that will shatter the matrix and shine light on the conditions and forces that are keeping the planet in third-dimensional density and inspire solutions and positive outcomes. Humanity needs to step up and desire to be freed from the darkness of this prison. No one, no thing outside of ourselves will do this for us. Ari Kopel helps us step into our power and authority that will shatter this prison. Now, be prepared to open up your consciousness, become aware, and emerge victorious by standing in our divine power and divine authority in unison, co-creating a new earth. Now, here's your host of Shattering the Matrix, Ari Kopel, and co-host Serena.
Hi, this is Ari Kopel with Shattering the Matrix. I'm also here with my co-host, Serena. We have a wonderful guest today. We have Rosemary Ellen Guiley, and she is one of the leading experts in the paranormal, has worked full-time as a researcher, author, and investigator since 1983. Her research includes all kinds of entity contact experiences, problem hauntings, interdimensional portals, spirit communications, past and parallel lives, dream work, angels, and more. She's the author of The Djinn Connection and more than 50 other books on a wide range of subjects, including groundbreaking research on shadow people. Rosemary is a consulting editor of Fate magazine. Her websites are visionaryliving.com and djinnuniverse.com, and that's djinnuniverse.com. Rosemary, welcome to our show.
Thank you, Ari and Serena. It's a pleasure to be with you.
Thank you very much. So honored to have you. We, as I was talking to you a little bit behind the scenes, Rosemary, one of the missions of our show and the reason that you were invited here is because we're looking for experts on the field that can give us and the audience some kind of clarity as to what's going on behind the scenes and what is possibly keeping humanity hijacked, shall we say, in many different levels, pretty much giving rise to what we call the matrix, you know, what's keeping humanity in bondage. You bring forth so much information with respect to this, that hopefully, you know, can give us the key or the pieces of the puzzle that would make this whole picture clearer. And so that's the reason that we, you know, we invited you in here, because you are that expert. So one of the things I wanted to ask you is because, you know, I'm very curious. I mean, I've read your book. It's absolutely fantastic, and I strongly recommend everybody to get a copy of your book, The Djinn Connection. Can you tell the audience a little bit just what got you started in this whole path and what you discovered in reference to the djinn? And then we're going to be talking, of course, a little bit more in depth about the djinn. But just explain to us what got you started, and if you can also enlighten us with any experience that you might have had firsthand with the djinn.
I've had a lot of experiences, many of them with them in their shadow people form. And shadow people are what really got me onto this trail. And it is a very disturbing picture that's emerging. And I know I'm one of many researchers who've been getting into this from a variety of angles. It's very complicated, complex. The roots of it go way, way back into our origins and from our ancient history on into the present. And I think we're still at the tip of the iceberg here. But I had gotten involved in the paranormal when I was very young, fascinated by it. And when I started my full-time career as an author of paranormal books in 1983, I was doing everything, angels, mystical experiences, dream work, intuition, fairies, ghosts and hauntings, vampires, mysterious creatures, I was really covering the map. UFOs and ETs, those have been an ongoing interest of mine. And over the course of time, I got more into problematic hauntings. That really was the first step on this path. There are certain kinds of hauntings that never go away, that never resolve, and the people who are exposed to them have a very predictable syndrome and pattern of experiences. Sometimes it has a lot to do with the people involved, sometimes it has a lot to do with the place. But not very many paranormal investigators like taking on those cases. And not that I was out gunning for them, because I never went looking for this stuff. It just sort of found me.
It usually does.
And I was intrigued about, well, what's going on here? Yeah. And people would automatically assume that dark entities were demons, and, you know, they were applying standard religious exorcism techniques to them that weren't working.
Mm-hmm.
Clearly something else was afoot.
Yeah.
Well, the universe directs me, and when I say that, you know, to, like a lot of people who are into their callings, we receive a lot of spiritual guidance in terms of doors opening and insights, illuminations, and, you know, so it is with me, that I am prompted to investigate certain lines of inquiry, and sometimes it's, you know, I'm guided there by people coming to me.
Yeah.
Well, that's what happened with the shadow people.
Huh.
And around 2004, I started getting a lot of inquiries from people describing the same sort of experience, which was a dark entity who invaded their bedrooms, terrifying and malevolent, even evil by some descriptions, who almost always looked like a dark silhouette of a man wearing a cape with a hood or a coat and a hat.
Mm-hmm.
And I got so many of these in a short period of time that it piqued my curiosity. You know, it was kind of a mini tidal wave. And I'd heard of these entities, but I really didn't know what they were specifically. And so that got me going and investigating shadow people,
mm-hmm.
which I naively assumed was going to be a short-term project. I would collect a few dozen cases, write some articles, and see what I came up with. Well, here I am, 9 years later.
Wow.
And shadow people wound up opening the door to an incredible web of hidden and underground connections.
Wow.
That's really what led me to the djinn and back to the djinn. I was already familiar with them from my research into witchcraft and sorcery and demonology. But I really didn't know much about them because there wasn't a lot of literature available in the English language.
Mm-hmm.
I read folk accounts and certainly the Arabian Nights and some more religious texts with an Islamic point of view.
Uh-huh.
Because the djinn who, they predate Islam, but they were absorbed into Islam, and they are discussed in the Quran and the Quranic commentaries. But shadow people defied explanation, and just to cut to the chase, you know, I determined after collecting hundreds of accounts that they definitely were not ghosts. There wasn't really anything human about them, even though they had a human-like appearance. They didn't fit demons and how demons seem to interact with people and what the demonic objectives are, so to speak. They weren't vampiric. I didn't think they were thought forms. They didn't seem to be ETs. I eliminated things one by one until I arrived at the djinn. And once I applied the djinn template to shadow people, I had a hit. And I concluded, and it is still my opinion, that shadow people are a form taken by djinn. And the term djinn means the hidden ones, by the way. And this is a great way to stay hidden. Just cloak yourself.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So the next question is, well, why are they doing this?
Yeah.
If they are djinn, then why are they taking this form and coming into people's bedrooms and lurking about in rather low-level haunted places?
Mm-hmm.
What's going on? So I went back to my problem haunting cases and re-examined them from the standpoint of could Djinn be involved? Because almost all of these cases involve shadow people and dark forms and bedroom invasions, as well as a host of other entities. And here again, after long, I'm compressing, of course, just long periods, months, even years of analyzing mythology, folklore, cross-cultural explanations, many different kinds of cases, it became evident to me that the Djinn, not only were they shadow people, but they probably accounted for all the forms that manifest in what I call persistent negative hauntings, because they are very artful shapeshifters.
Wow.
And through the course of that, then, the other major line of research that opened up was the ET angle.
Mm-hmm.
And I discovered, first of all, a significant number of my shadow people experiencers volunteered that they were also ET experiencers. So sort of like, oh, by the way, I don't know if this is connected, but I've had, you know, ET encounters, I've been abducted.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't get this in angel encounters, fairy encounters, even what I would call ordinary ghosts and hauntings, this connection with the abducting ET. So that led to another line of inquiry that consumed a few years of study, because I went back to the abduction literature and I thought, well, are shadow people involved in ET abductions? When I started asking those questions of shadow people experiencers, have you had ET abductions? I got an astounding number of positive responses. So it seemed that shadow people had a very interesting role in the ET abduction scenario.
Interesting.
Well, this brings, can I ask a question here at this point? This is making me think of what is typically called men in black. Do you find any relationship with what is called the men in black to these shadow people? Because these shadow people, you say they're typically, they're male, they're wearing suits and hats, and that pretty much looks like what men in black are wearing. Could this be another aspect of them, do you think?
I believe it is, and I consider men in black to be a form taken by Djinn as well. When I was researching shadow people, that was one of the first connections I made. I couldn't help but think, you know, wow, these guys look like silhouette forms of the men in black who plague ET experiencers. And that was yet another link to the ET phenomenon. But what intrigued me the most was the fact that the bedroom invaders also were connected to this ET experience, which is usually a bedroom invasion experience.
Mm-hmm.
So I did find, and this is what I discuss in the Djinn connection, that the footprints of the Djinn as shadow people and shape-shifted entities, they're all over the abduction.
Yeah.
And yet they've been overlooked. The whole shadow person presence has been overlooked because they just haven't been on the radar of most ufologists and abduction researchers. We've been focused on the grays, on reptilians, on humanoids, on the hybrid thing. And when I went to abduction researchers and attempted to find out if they had noticed or pursued this interesting phenomenon, I was brushed off by most of them, with the exception of Anne Druffel, who had already made that connection, although she hadn't really connected the shadow people to Djinn, but she was aware of the potential role of the Djinn in all of these kinds of experiences. Now, the shadow people do not come along with the abducting ETs. They usually precede an abduction.
Gotcha.
Wow.
And so the questions that we have then are, what is the role of the Djinn in the abduction phenomenon?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
The grays as well? Are they collaborating with grays or other entities?
Right.
Are they everything that we're experiencing? Are they working against these other entities for their own interests?
Right.
Well, they would have an interest in the hybrid program.
Yeah.
Which David Jacobs has researched in depth. about the reasons why these alien beings want to have hybrid offspring with us. And we find in researching the Djinn lore that this interest of theirs goes back to ancient times. And in ancient times, it was believed that Djinn-human hybrids were among us and that they were very dangerous beings.
Mm-hmm.
So from there, then from the abducting ETs, then we spread out into all kinds of things, like ancient aliens in general, the gods and goddesses that were written about in ancient times.
Sure.
How many of them exhibited Djinn characteristics?
Yeah.
And marked similarities across the board.
Mm-hmm.
I can't say, like some, there are researchers around the world, and I've consulted with experts in sorcery. I have Islamic sources, Middle Eastern sources, ufologists, paranormal investigators around the globe that I have consulted with on this. And there are some who say, look, everything's Djinn. You know, you might as well just, you know, hang up your hat right now. You know, the ancients knew it. There were angels and Djinn, and that's it.
Who was saying this? I'm sorry, who was saying this? Everything is Djinn. Who says it?
Many researchers around around the world who are very familiar with the Djinn, and that is a very also would be a very typical view from a Middle Eastern perspective that all of these shape-shifted forms are Djinn.
Huh.
Now I can't in at my stage in my research, I'm not willing to take that step yet. I'm not convinced of that myself.
Mm-hmm.
I'm open to the possibility. In research, you have to be open to all kinds of possibilities.
Sure.
Had to revise some of my cherished notions many times over.
Right.
But what I am saying is the presence of the Djinn is deeply embedded in all of our entity contact experiences, to the point where we may not know in any given situation exactly what we're dealing with. And that has a purpose, because they have an agenda. They are masterful shapeshifters, and they can keep themselves very hidden. One of their tactics would be to keep us distracted on a variety of fronts.
Yep.
Play to a lot of our beliefs and assumptions and whatnot, so that we think that, you know, keep us busy. It's like a war. You know, you keep the enemy distracted and as busy on all fronts as possible, so you can get on with your real agenda.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what we're in the process of discovering.
Yeah. It's very evident, even when we take a look at the way that, that you know, just reading our headlines, you can tell how we're being distracted, you know, and in the meantime, you know, while we're looking this way, they're sneaking out and doing stuff, you know, in the back, through the back door. I have a question, and just, well, it's not even a question, it's just I'm going to pose this possibility and see what you think. Is it a possibility that the people that are being visited by the Djinn and these shadow people, which obviously these visitations with the shadow people precede ET abductions and visitations, is it a possibility that those people have a predisposition to maybe having a certain openings or certain aspects in their field and their energy field or something that attracts these beings to them a little bit more than maybe other people? Have you even thought about that as a possibility? Or
I have, Ari, and I have factored that into my ongoing research.
Uh-huh.
I believe that is a very significant factor in these pervasive, invasive and ongoing experiences. Whether you look at persistent negative hauntings that don't resolve, spirit attachments, the abductions and whatnot, many of these individuals are lifelong experiencers. They seem to be born with an attunement or an openness to these other dimensional realities.
Mm-hmm.
That makes them more accessible or more attractive or both to certain kinds of entities. And they have lifelong histories of all kinds of experiences where we have family situations, multi-generational things going on. And this applies to shadow people, who follow generations, djinn, even fairies, and they're all interrelated, by the way. I think the djinn are heavily involved in the fairy phenomenon.
Huh, interesting.
And the abducting ETs, there is always at least one family member who's markedly open.
Yeah.
And so then there's a chicken and egg thing, like, are these people born that way and the entities can see that and they're attracted to that because they know that they can, insert themselves and do some influence and manipulating? Or are these people, is this openness one of certain genetic characteristics that is part of a mix of things that makes them appealing for this kind of manipulation? But almost across the board, it's if someone starts telling me certain kinds of experiences and I can start going back into their life paranormal history, it's very predictable.
Yeah.
The kinds of things that they have experienced, and it's almost like I could finish their sentences for them. It's a pattern.
Yeah.
There are people who have one-off experiences or might have a series of experiences. For example, when the djinn come in this shadow person form, I think that they feed off this fear energy that they generate in us. And some of them may just have that purpose. They might see someone who's going through an emotionally vulnerable period, because sometimes people in crisis, life crisis situations, will have a spate of shadow people encounters. And I think that they, it's like a bloodhound that can smell something.
Yep.
You know, they get attracted to it. They know they can get a life force hit off these people, and so they take what they can get, and then they move on. Some years ago, I coined a term for this kind of visitation. I called them drive-by demons. You know, they're just cruising around looking for the opportunistic hit.
Yeah. Yeah, interesting. Do you have you encountered djinn or slash shadow people that will visit for the purpose of possession, to have the individual do their dirty work or do things that they would not normally do?
Yes, there are a variety of motives and fronts of operation that are going on. And here's another thing that I find very puzzling, is that when human beings look at these otherworldly entities, we expect them to be cookie-cut things. Mm-hmm. You know, that they're all the same, they all do the same, they all look, it's like the abducting greys, they all look the same, they all do the same, they're either all evil, all good. And they're not like that. They're as mixed as we are. And they have a variety of powers, a variety of intentions. Some of them are tricksters. Some of them seem to want to entertain themselves at our expense. Some have sexual interests in us, even romantic infatuations. Some are very hostile and malevolent. They want to harm human beings. They want to take the life force. Possession would be another way to do that. And abduction is part of it as well. So we have things that go on in a variety of ways. There are people who have very severe problems with invasive entities who think that they might be able to possess someone. And I think that most human beings have natural buffers against these, or we would just all be robotic, you know, automaton slaves of other entities.
Although, sure. Mm-hmm.
There are conspiracists who say, you know, we are anyway.
Right. Yeah.
Some people don't seem to have very good boundaries at keeping these entities out.
Mm-hmm.
And possession, the djinn can possess, they can mentally influence. And they're very good deal makers.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the abducting ETs, or what we're calling the abducting ETs, actually, I think they're interdimensional entities. They don't seem to be real interested in deal making. It's like our way, and, you know, this is what's going to happen to you, and you're not going to be able to stop it. And they could, those kinds of things could go on in the djinn front as well, too. But oftentimes, when djinn seek to manipulate people on another kind of level of everyday life, it's a deal-making sort of things. And of course, we know that from the demonic world too, that there are various ways of getting these deals out of people. And I find them coming out in the most peculiar ways. Sometimes people will inadvertently make a deal when they're trying to get relief of something. For example, like I have cases where people say, you know, all right, if you stop pestering me, you can, you know, have whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Or if they see their children being affected, it's like, don't bother them, bother me.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's a deal.
Right.
And people, of course, and we see this from the religious perspective concerning demons, people who want power, they want to manipulate others, they want fame or fortune or whatever. It's very easy to enter into tacit pacts with spirits who will help that along. Some people actively seek spirit help. They want to conjure or summon or do some sort of magical ritual. But with a lot of people, it's on a level of consciousness, like, you know, these are my objectives. Well, there are entities who will help those objectives,
mm-hmm.
and that becomes a kind of pact as well.
Right.
These pacts can follow generations. They become generational curses. And what the djinn want, ultimately, besides manipulation, is life force energy. And they can take that through a vampirizing of your health and luck and things like that. Or they can take it through blood, through some sort of blood sacrifice. That is, untimely death, accident, you know, that sort of thing.
Interesting. Very interesting. I'm wondering if, you know, a lot of people, unfortunately, may not be aware that maybe they are influenced by either being possessed or they're influenced by some kind of djinn or shadow person or whatever. And, you know, sometimes, you know, they infiltrate our minds, these things, and, you know, we start getting, you know, into that depressive state and all that. Is there any generic, of all the research you've done and interviews you've done, have you been able to decipher a pattern for symptoms for an individual that might be under djinn influence?
I find that many of them suffer either chronic depression or bouts of depression, or you know, they have a lot of tumultuous feelings going on inside of them. And earlier I was commenting on, you know, people in life crises. Some of the cases where the influence is more ongoing and pervasive, we find, and this is not 100% by any means,
mm-hmm.
but many people who are struggling with a lot of emotional issues. And of course, we know that chronic depression can be clinical as well. People can have chemical imbalances that predisposes them to chronic depression. So those can be factors as well that seem to make it easier for certain kinds of predatory entities to gain a foothold with someone. And oftentimes, you know, there are all sorts of remedies, and some of them address symptoms, and some of them really try to address the root causes of things. We have exorcisms, we have amulets, we have all sorts of prophylactic measures. All of them work, but not all of them work in all cases, and some of them are not very effective against the djinn at all. What seems to be significant, and Anne Druffel wrote about this years ago in the abduction literature, and I think it still applies today and it applies to the djinn, is that people have to gain an equilibrium within themselves. That's not the total answer, but it is a very significant component, is that you have to summon up something from within yourself that pushes out your sovereign boundaries. And that's the term that she used, and I picked it up as well, sovereignty.
Mm-hmm.
Marshall V.N. Summers also talks about our sovereignty when
right.
it comes to invasive aliens. I think, and I've discussed this with other researchers, I think that the way some of our society is organized, it encourages this weakness in sovereignty. We're very susceptible to influences in the mass media. The internet makes us even more susceptible than ever, because we're just bombarded all the time with microwaves, EMF. It's very possible to embed subliminal messages and things. And people can become far more vulnerable than they might realize. So how do we do that? Well, you have to be a well. How do you have your sovereignty? You have to summon up something within yourself through finding your spiritual roots, your connection to the greater whole.
Right.
Meditation is a good way to do that. And knowing yourself very well, and being very self-directed.
Right.
There's no easy answer to a lot of these things. But,
right.
You know, everybody goes through bad bouts of depression. You know, you get knocked for a loop, and sometimes it takes you a while to get back on your feet.
Yeah.
And some people seem to have more difficulty being able to do that than others.
Yeah.
They are more likely to become a target.
Yeah, and I've noticed that you know, through other experts, of course, that that traumas, early childhood traumas, tend to obviously create you know, openings and situations for people where these tend to obviously get visited more often, you know, either by djinn or ETs. So. That is probably a factor right there, where trauma is probably created on purpose, maybe because they're targeting those people. I don't know, the lineage, like you were saying. So very interesting stuff.
Things can get very complicated, and we can find some past life connections. For example, in the Middle East, it's well known that the djinn can follow families through generations.
Yeah.
And reach out from the past, literally. And from other perspectives, that could be put into a past life context as well as a bloodline succession of descendants. So some of these influences may be operating in the background, and we might not even be aware of it. The people who've come forward in the ET abduction literature have a lot of these characteristics of lifelong experiences, some things that start very early in childhood, entire families being affected, and you can trace some patterns, you know, going back a little bit in time. But you know, I also hasten to add that not every childhood experience of a paranormal nature, or even some of the difficulties that children go through, is going to pan out along these lines. And I've been asked this a lot about dreams, because there is such a thing as entity invasion in dreams, and that's often how entities will try and manipulate people.
Right.
But every bad dream is not an entity invasion dream, or has a supernatural purpose or context. And children will often have bad dreams of monsters and attackers and, you know, that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to approach this. We have to eliminate natural causes first before we jump to supernatural reasons. But the supernatural picture that's emerging is, as I mentioned early in our conversation, it's getting more and more disturbing.
Yeah.
The more researchers are uncovering things.
So what do you when you say it's getting more disturbing, does that mean that there's more evidence of it, or it's just more rampant right now?
I believe that negative entity contact experiences are on the rise. Now, some of it is due to increased self-reporting, because more people are coming forward with their experiences. They're comfortable doing so, or they realize that what's happening to them is happening to other people.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, I and other researchers like me who are in this arena feel that it is on the increase, and that there are these thinning of boundaries between the dimensions going on. We seem to have just limited access to these beings, or perhaps even a better way of putting it would be they have limited access to us. I believe they come through interdimensional portals that have natural land-based geophysical conditions and characteristics. Certainly the wild card of human consciousness plays a factor in it as well.
Yeah.
But these boundaries seem to be thinning. And is that because of changes in our consciousness, our technology, solar flares, whatever? It could be a combination of things. And the picture that emerges is this matrix scenario where one has to start asking, well, how much have we been genetically manipulated, created, monitored, and how much are we really being manipulated today? And it's some of the scenarios are very disturbing and even frightening.
Mm-hmm.
And how much of them are true? We're still seeing just tips of the iceberg here, and it's definitely something that we need to examine more closely.
Yeah. Rosemary, I had dropped, my call got dropped off a little while back, and I had a couple of questions. I realized I should have written them down, but you just mentioned, I did have something to say, but I'm going to ask the question first, but you just mentioned some geophysical locations that you think may be like portals where these djinn are coming in and out of. Can you talk more about that? And then I have another statement.
That's funny, because I was going to ask the same question.
Okay. These portals are all over the planet. And, of course, other researchers have written about them. You know, John Keel back in the 70s and 80s talked about windows. That term has been used in ufology as well. To me, and this is goes back to the beginning of my research in the paranormal, it made sense to me that things happened more in certain areas because there were thin boundaries between wherever these beings existed and were coming from to have access to this world. And there are some big portals and there are small portals. You know, your house could sit on a portal.
Oh, yeah.
So years ago,
I'm a portal.
You're a portal. Yeah, people can be portals.
Yeah.
You know, and you know, just this profile we've been talking about.
Mm-hmm.
But I started collecting characteristics of what I call paranormal hot zones. You know, areas where waves of UFO activity take place. Certain kinds of mysterious creatures seem to congregate. Persistent negative hauntings. Areas that seem to be wider areas that seem to be plagued with ongoing paranormal activity. And here again, we find consistent profiles mm-hmm. that emerge, which cannot be applied 100% across the board. Nothing in the paranormal is 100%. It's a very blurry landscape, but nonetheless, consistent profiles. And there are certain characteristics that apply to these areas. Not every single portal area is going to have all of them, but would certainly have some of the most significant. Geophysically, soil content.
Huh.
If there is a high presence of things like quartz, magnetite, iron, things with their own natural electrical properties, caves, mining tunnels, also subterranean water and water that breaks through the surface. There's an ionization from running water. Being near large bodies of water and sometimes major river areas, if you're in proximity of that. These are significant characteristics. Magnetic anomalies, that portal areas almost always have some sort of positive, marked positive or negative magnetic anomaly. That is, the magnetic properties of the location are significantly higher or lower than surrounding areas. And so if someone is describing to me an area that has a lot of weird ongoing paranormal activity, I can almost predict what I'm going to find there geophysically.
Interesting.
And this is pretty consistent. So this is an area that's very, very hard to study, especially from any sort of scientific perspective. For one thing, few people have a magnetometer that they can go out and measure these things.
Mm-hmm.
We can get general pictures from surveys that have been done. The U.S. Geological Survey has a lot of these on maps. But it's a profile that fits these areas. And, for example, let's take the Bridgewater Triangle in Massachusetts,
mm-hmm.
Which is roughly triangular in shape, but that's kind of an artificial definition of it. The term was created as sort of a play off the Bermuda Triangle.
Mm-hmm.
But we have, within this area, well, we have missing people, phantom hitchhikers, troll-like creatures called the Pukwudgies that are harmful to people, probably a form taken by Djinn, occult activity, apparitions, a lot of things that accident, places where a lot of accidents happen. And what do we have in the triangle? Well, we have at the center of this area a swamp. And
a what? I'm sorry.
A swamp.
A swamp, okay.
It's called the Hockomock Swamp.
Okay.
And then there are a lot of negative magnetic anomalies in this area as well. So this swamp, areas of swampy conditions often have mysterious creatures roaming around in them. They seem to be areas where we see a lot of mysterious lights. There's often UFO corridors around them. So these geophysical features create energy patterns, literally in the aura of this planet, that warp space in some subtle energy way. And they can give rise to these corridors or portal areas where things can come and go in this world. That would be the best paranormal way of explaining it. And
that is interesting. I was not expecting that answer.
Yeah,
that,
no, that's a good one.
Yeah, that geoportals would be found, the common patterns would be found in soil and soil content, magnetics and water, places with water and swampy areas or quartz. So as you're saying all those things, I'm thinking Bermuda Triangle, and you touched upon that, but there is definitely something strange happening here where that Bermuda Triangle is. And, I mean, everybody that comes from outside of Florida will tell you they feel an energy when they come in and that it's crazy. And they ask me when they come in, what is wrong with Florida? Why does it feel so crazy here? And then I have no idea, but I feel it. We talk about it. I have a neighbor who went away for a week, went to Wisconsin, came back, and he felt the craziness when he came back. And when you're in it, you kind of get used to it or lost in it. But when you go away and you come back, you feel it. My housemate, he just came back from a week-long cruise. When he came back, he felt the craziness too. And he's not the most sensitive person in the world, I have to tell you. But he feels it. They feel it like a wall. And I think that it has to do with this Bermuda Triangle. And I think there's a huge, huge crystal down there, a huge crystal that has been really, heavily programmed by whoever was working on it or however it wound up down there, Atlantean history or something. But there is definitely a lot of stuff happening in this area of Florida.
And I have something else to ask in reference to this, Rosemary. Because I noticed that, the Middle East, for example, is a hotbed for so much fighting and, just war, just death and bloodshed and,
turmoil.
It's extreme. And because of the Djinn and the connection with the religions over there, including, with Solomon and all that,
Is there a pattern with that particular territory as well? I mean, does it fit any of the patterns that you discuss about the soil and things like that? Or is there a portal there?
Well, the djinn really exist everywhere.
Yeah.
Even though what we know about them comes from very well-developed folklore and mythology in the Middle East, we would not limit fairies, for example, to Celtic countries.
Sure.
That's where the dominant lore is. In Middle Eastern lore, in pre-Islamic times, ancient Arabian legends, their origins were ascribed to the winds, and these would be the ill winds that blew across the desert, bringing disease and, you know, things like that, the pestilence. And the Quran describes the djinn as having been created from smokeless fire, and the angels from a pure spiritual light. And when they were banished, when the djinn were banished, the creation story told in the Quran is that when human beings were created out of earth and water, Allah instructed the angels to bow to Adam, and the angels complied, but the djinn, who had access to the heavens with the angels, refused because human beings were considered to be inferior, and for that they were cast out. They were banished and then given a reprieve until Judgment Day to make their case that human beings were unworthy of this sort of status. So when they got banished, well, from a modern perspective, they get banished to another dimension. Huh. They're still connected to the earth, but they're in another space, so to speak. Well, in ancient times, this was considered to be the wastelands, that this would be the loneliest parts of the desert, caves, remote areas, and also dirty areas, polluted areas. These were considered to be the abodes of the banished djinn. So how do we relate that to what's going on in the Middle East today? Well, here again, we can't really isolate them out as being unique, because every place on the planet has had enormous upheavals,
yeah,
through periods. And for example, the Inquisition,
sure,
that seized Europe, well, how much of that had spirit influence? It probably had just as much as what's going on in the Middle East today.
Sure.
From a Middle Eastern perspective, the djinn are assumed to be involved in this.
Huh.
They feed off chaos. They like upset. They're like the arms merchant. They'll play both sides against each other because they win in the end.
Mm-hmm.
And they can be summoned and sent against enemies. This is assumed in many parts of the Middle East, and we've seen that surface in the Western press from time to time. Westerners tend to look on this as primitive superstition. But we've had the same culture ourselves in the past. We have popes who talk to angels and send angels out. What's so different? You're sending an entity out to do your business for you.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So, in fact, one of the things that I'm researching right now is the role of the djinn in the Arab Spring.
Huh.
And
that's interesting.
Can we, you know, are there ways to document this or account for this? Well, I've interviewed people over in the Middle East who assume that the djinn are involved and say that, yes, this would be something that they would do, but, you know, pinpointing exact things. Wherever we have unrest in the world, I think we can assume that some sort of entities are involved in this, and that this manipulation goes back to ancient times. I believe that the watchers mentioned in the Bible were, mm-hmm, really djinn. They were not angels. They were not fallen angels or any kind of angels. They were djinn. They were assigned to watch over humanity, and they started coveting human women, and, you know, decide they're going to have that. But they strike a deal to do it. In exchange for teaching the forbidden arts, they get sex. And what happens? We have hybrid offspring called the Nephilim, who are corrupt, they're flesh eaters, they're blood drinkers, they spread violence around the globe, and we have the flood as the remedy for that.
What's a way to how would you describe the djinn? Are they a combination of inorganic / organic? How would they actually have sex with a human and then produce an actual being that would be a flesh, even though maybe they're interdimensional, I don't know, but still they're producing something that is a being. How does that happen? Do you know?
Well, of course, the scientists will tell you it's impossible.
Right.
But we have these traditions going back to ancient times, and we find it in fairy lore, too. A lot of fairy human hybrids. And now we have the ET thing, we have djinn, we have demonics. Various explanations have been put forward to try and explain how it's done. Now, the djinn, nobody really knows what the true form of the djinn consists of.
Yeah.
They're made of smokeless fire. What's that? Is it plasma?
Right.
Is it some other unknown energy? They do seem to be able to shapeshift into whatever form they like and can assume some sort of tangible form.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we find this in demonic cases as well, where people have described incubus and succubus sexual activity, including rape, that the forms are tangible. And sometimes they're not seen, but they're felt, and they feel real. They feel like either flesh and blood form, or in some cases they're hideous, they're more monstrous. But the actual penetration is felt. And what we see in the ET scenario is that the abductees, the women abductees, they say they become pregnant, but the entities come and take the fetus out of them before it's born. And we have cases of pregnancies that mysteriously, cease to be. Or if they actually give birth, that the entities come and take it shortly after birth. And these are anecdotal accounts that are very hard to verify by actual tangible evidence.
Yeah.
But they are capable of having this sort of intercourse. I do believe that there are hybrids, and that there are hybrids walking around on the planet today that we have no idea that they're part us and part something else. The people have asked, well, why? Why do hybrids? What's the point of that? Well, if you were beings who wanted to exist on this planet, but you had some sort of form that prevented you from being here all the time, or there were some obstacles, one of the things that you would consider would be having a genetic form, a physical form that could be here. With a hybrid, and this is what the ancients feared about the djinn-human hybrid, they would have a human form, but they would have the djinn allegiance and superpowers, super abilities that would make them very dangerous to human beings. Well, I would like to mention one very convoluted explanation that the Inquisition theologians proposed for how could demons have actual sexual intercourse with human beings and produce offspring.
Mm-hmm.
And the convoluted explanation was that the demon would assume a male form, an incubus form, and have had to start with a succubus, a female form. The succubus would go to a man, mm-hmm. and cause him to have an emission,
right.
and collect that semen from him, and then take it and assume an incubus or male form and go to a woman and have intercourse where that was, used to impregnate the woman. And a very unsatisfactory explanation, and also doesn't, but theologians at that time assumed that demons were sexless, that they were incapable of having sex, but mm-hmm. they would perpetrate this foul act on human beings to torment them.
Mm-hmm.
So we don't have any good scientific evidence or explanations for these things, but I find it very puzzling and intriguing that we have, throughout the entire course of human history, accounts of these things happening.
Yeah.
going back to the ancient demigods who were supposedly, you know, the Greeks and the Babylonians, all of the ancient cultures have accounts of the gods impregnating human beings to create demigods and races of heroes and that sort of thing. So it seems to be a part of our existence. And perhaps these are the beings who either created us or are involved in our creation and management.
That's a lot.
Yeah.
Rosemary. And it leads to so many questions. Now, Ari and I just did an interview with John Lamb Lash, and we talked about the Archons and how he has extrapolated information by the Gnostics and the Nag Hammadi Library and their story about how the Archons came into being, because we're still trying to figure out what the Archons are and how they work and what their role is as well. Now, I find it to be very similar to the Djinn story, because it is said that both the Archons and the Djinn were created before humanity was created, right? And so my question is, with all of these manipulations that these creatures are doing with humanity, and I believe that there is a variety. I believe there are Archons, there are Djinn, there are ETs, there are creatures, goblins, you know, how do you say, blob-type creatures. I've seen those. I've seen the shadow men, but without clothing, just human form. Personally, they tried to kill me. I have an experience with that. But I think there is a variety. But if these creatures existed before humanity, a lot of people are saying that they feed on human energy. But what did they feed on before humans even existed? So the reason I'm asking that is because I do feel that they feed on the energy, like they thrive in it, they get kicks from it, but I don't think they need it as food to survive. I think that they are just trying to manipulate a species, humanity in our case, because they hate, and they're full of hate or anger, revenge, whatever, you name it, jealousy, whatever it is, and they're doing it because they're just trying to make a lot of people's lives miserable. They're just angry, hurt, hateful. And but I don't really think that they need food and that we are their food. I think that's another story. So what do you think about that?
The vampirization that goes on of the life force energy, I do not think it's necessary to their survival.
Right.
It's desirable thing to them.
Yeah.
And knowing that it's harmful to us probably makes it appealing to the more malevolent and hostile of them. I've stressed all along in my research that the djinn being like us, they're the good, the bad, and the ugly. And we can't paint them all as malevolent and hostile. But there is a hostile faction of them. Mm-hmm. And if they were thrown out because of us, well, that's a lot of hostility.
Yeah.
Human beings have that all the time when they're displaced from their homelands. We fight over territory and our right to be someplace. So this could be a long-standing grudge for revenge and hostility on the part of the djinn. And they are known, they have been known since ancient times for being exceptionally vengeful if they feel they're wronged. So they would, the hostile ones may, this hostile faction may account for a lot of this negative activity. Now I've talked to people about, you know, are there good djinn, are there benevolent djinn? And there are djinn who seem to do helpful things to people or for people, but even those are regarded with a great deal of reserve, and it's kind of a reluctant sort of relationship, because the djinn are considered to be very self-serving, not very trustworthy, and very unpredictable. It's like they can gain the upper hand very easily. So these beings are not something that I would encourage anyone to actively seek out. I'm amazed at the number of emails I get from people. Oh, how could I conjure a djinn?
Really?
Why would you want to, you know, sell yourself into a lifelong difficulty?
Right.
You know, predatory entities.
Yeah, and the thing is that they are really, literally immortal. I mean, so they can, like, harass you for eternity if they wanted to.
Are they immortal, or do they have a lifespan?
In djinn lore, they have lifespans, but from our perspective, they might as well be immortal because their lifespans could reach into the thousands of years. So, you know, we have these cases where remedies are applied and the djinn seem to go away and stop bothering people. But have they gone away permanently? We don't know. They could be away for the rest of somebody's entire life, in which case we consider it a permanent solution, and they're just out on a coffee break.
Yeah, exactly. Can you tell us what some of these remedies are, please?
A lot of it depends on the kind of situation that you're involved in, because these are constellations of phenomena, and there's no universal band-aid, so to speak. And people think that there are. So there are a variety of things that people have to try. If the dominant problem is shadow person visits, then I usually suggest to people that they might try disrupting EMF fields by keeping lights on, televisions, radios. Those often work to diminish the activity and sometimes even repel it altogether. You know, we don't know what the motives are, the abilities of the shadow person. Some of them are highly resistant to just about everything we can apply, and others seem to be much more easily banished.
You know, it's interesting, before you go on with the other remedies, it's interesting you mentioned that one, because I saw some videos recently about these telephone towers, cell phone towers that they're erecting everywhere. And a lot of these people that are gauging the amount of power that comes out from them are saying that it is way too much power that is being utilized, that they say is for cell phone use over, you know, areas that they have designated those cell phone towers for. They're saying that they could cut that amount of power that is coming from those cell towers in half, and people would still have good reception on their phones. They don't know why there is so much power that is being emitted from them, and it just makes no sense. So with this conversation, it starts to make sense why there would be so much EMF frequencies being emitted, if there is an agenda, which I happen to believe there is, to bring in a lot of these entities at this time right now.
The thing about the pervasive amount of EMF that we're bombarding ourselves with, I haven't yet ascertained how much of it is helping them and how much of it is harming them. In the Djinn Connection, I talk about the scuttlers in England who seem to be related to the shadow people. I don't think they're limited to England by any means, but that concerns some English cases where these forms were disrupting radio broadcast energy. Now, was it the energy that was harmful to them, or was it the purpose of the broadcast energy? Because how they got discovered was through pirate radio stations that were trying to influence a cessation of the hostilities between Northern Ireland and Ireland. So did the interfering entities not want the fighting to stop, or was it the frequencies being broadcast that were harmful to their presence in those particular areas? I have another shadow person case that shadow people started plaguing a business that was a salvage business that takes apart computers and cell phone towers and salvages out the good parts and resells them. And when they got a contract to start taking apart old cell phone towers, the shadow people started showing up.
Wow.
To watch what was being done. This was during the day. To watch what was being done, to steal their parts and their tools. So were they, what was the purpose here? Were they trying to figure out how these things work so they could cut the harmful energy, or how maybe they wanted to see how they could make use of the energy? But there's something going on with the EMF in these beings. Now, if these beings are made out of smokeless fire and there's some sort of plasmic energy, they could be enhanced or disrupted by electricity and EMF and magnetic fields on this planet. And this is something that we need to figure out. But we have to look for the patterns and the characteristics to emerge in these cases before we can arrive at solutions. And we get no help at all, of course, from science.
Right. So you're saying that if you cut off some of the EMFs in the house, cut off some of the power, this can eliminate some of the harassment that's coming from the shadow forms.
No, if you increase it.
If you increase it. Oh, I misunderstood. The first remedy you were talking about, if you increase the EMFs, you get less harassment?
If you leave the lights on, if you leave the TV on, TV and lights seem to be very disruptive to a lot of shadow people manifestations. Quite often people turn the light on, they'll disappear. Now, are they disappearing because suddenly they're in a field of energy that makes it harder for them to be there, or they just don't want you to observe them? It could be both. They're hidden, by the way. They don't want us to know what they're doing. Right. So they're not going to stand there and answer questions and let us examine them. So people have a lot of success with that. Unfortunately, a lot of times what works for a while stops working. And they're like bacteria that develop resistance to whatever, antibiotic you want to use. People have said prayer works for them. Doesn't matter what kind of prayer, as long as it's potent for you. That's also a remedy that comes and goes very easily and works for one person and not another.
Yeah, I've experienced that too, yeah.
I have recommended disruptions of energy fields by using iron. These are old folk remedies, mm-hmm. to count iron nails or stakes around the corners of a house to keep iron in the bedroom. It's a very ancient remedy against the fairies, by the way.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Mm-hmm.
Because it's disruptive to their ability to manifest in our reality. Mm-hmm. So people have used the Seal of Solomon as an amulet, a protective amulet. Sometimes religious symbols will work for people. I think it's, your connection to that. Here again, it's sovereignty. It's yep. your spiritual connection to mm-hmm. a force that's greater than you yep. that helps you, repel something. In cases where Islamic scholars and clerics have been called in to help situations, they will take certain written verses from the Quran, sayings of Muhammad, a letter from Muhammad. There's a certain letter written by Muhammad about the jinn that's considered to be very effective. And if it's printed on parchment and rolled up and imbued with prayers, the way we would pray over a relic or a cross, for example, that this generates a spiritual energy, which can be very beneficial as well. So people have experimented with minerals, clays, anything with an electrical property to it, the quartzite, crystals.
What would they do with the clay or minerals? What would they do with it?
You can place them around in a room to absorb or deflect negative energy. It's a type of feng shui, and this is what the ancient art of feng shui is all about. It's about manipulating natural energies to magnify beneficial energies and repel negative energies. The same principles are at work with these amuletic sorts of things. Well, a lot of these remedies, as you can tell from the description of them, they they address the symptoms but not the cause.
Yep.
And sometimes that's all we can do is keep addressing the symptoms. Now, I've had cases where we've shifted from one thing to another. You know, it's like this works a while, then that works. And, you know, exorcisms, Catholic, Protestant, shamanic, Buddhist, you know, take your pick.
Wow.
They can all work. But do they provide lasting relief? And in many cases, they don't. They provide a temporary relief.
Exactly.
I had one case where we did a tobacco offering. We got some genuine ceremonial tobacco from the local Native Americans and made a smoke offering. And that quieted things down for several months, and then it was back. The sad thing is, and the distressing thing is, that in the worst of these cases, where these entities literally have a hold in the land, and this is something else that seems to be a characteristic of these portal areas, is their land-based attachments. And dislodging these entities from the land is extremely difficult, if not impossible, in many cases, and people wind up just throwing in the towel and moving. and I don't, you know, I don't recommend to people, look, you know, you're just going to have to move because you don't know how yeah. things are going to play out, and you can't just tell people to tear up their homes. But in major portal areas where the activity has been ongoing, we often find where people have built homes in these areas, developments, that there is a very peculiar high rate of real estate turnover. And it's difficult to tie these things to supernatural causes.
Mm-hmm.
But when you start looking for the patterns and making the associations, they add up in very mysterious ways.
Yeah, they do. And I personally had a home just like you're describing, and it also happened to have been in Florida. And I had a huge portal in my home where, I mean, this was like Grand Central Station. I mean, they were coming up and down the stairs. They were taking my keys, taking keys out of my keychain and placing them in different parts of the house. You know, stuff like that. I mean, it was like unbelievable. But I have found, though, that when I go to, and I move to a particular house, like the house I just moved to here that I live in Nashville now, there was activity here also. So my question is, am I moving into areas that have these open portals and, you know, happen to have these djinn and other things in there, or am I bringing them to the properties?
or are you the portal?
That's it. Or am I the portal?
Well, John Zappas and I have had conversations in the past where we shake our heads and we say, why is it that the most vulnerable people to these things always seem to find the worst places to move?
Yeah.
You know, it's and it could very well be that we have certain sensitivities mm-hmm. to things in the landscape that attract us, and they come with this sort of activity.
Yeah.
So we find ourselves going from, you know, frying pan into the fire sometimes. But, you know, there are people who can live in these portal areas and not be bothered.
Yeah.
They're just switched off in that regard. And, you know, here again, this is another thing where the skeptics will point the finger and say, well, it's all in your head because it didn't happen to so-and-so. You know, why is it happening to you? What's your problem?
Right. Yeah.
I think, however, our consciousness is evolving, and a lot of it has to do with this global internet stuff, which is connecting us now. Things go viral and nothing flat. Our consciousness can be impacted in a nanosecond by something halfway around the world. These things are changing our consciousness irrevocably. And they're sensitizing us to these other dimensional realities that share the planet with us. These are not beings coming from outer space. I don't deny that that can't happen and hasn't happened and isn't happening. But most of this activity is tied to planet Earth.
Hmm.
And we've been blind to it. Most of us have been happily blind to it for a good chunk of human history. but collectively we are stepping into a new reality of what I have named the interdimensional Earth, and we're going to have to live in it and find ways to live in it without destroying ourselves and allowing other beings to impinge on us as well. We can't have this attitude of, oh, I don't like it, I'm going to get rid of it, call the exorcist. Because these other dimensions have a stake in the Earth too. And there are beings who have shared the planet with us from the very beginning. And we're not always going to automatically be able to sweep them out of our way for the sake of our convenience.
Right.
So how do we deal with that?
Yeah, that's a really good
That's
the million-dollar question, because and just real quick, let me sneak this one in. Are they capable, though, of sweeping us off the Earth?
Oh, God.
Unfortunately, I believe they are.
So we gotta play. We gotta play nice, but they can't. Okay.
And this is a scenario that I see reflected back, no matter where I turn in this kind of of research. And other investigators are finding the same thing, that this planet, the beings who share the planet with us, many of them have the capability of just getting us out of the way, like we would call pest control to get rid of ants in a house, and that they might even regard us in that way.
Yeah.
And why, the question is, well, why hasn't that happened? And I've been asked that. Well, if these beings are so powerful and they dislike us so much, why haven't they just wiped us off the planet? I think they've tried in the past.
Yeah.
We may not know, we have the awareness of the information yet as to why that hasn't happened. Is it our natural buffers? Is it some sort of divine covenant we have, like the Bible speaks about? Are there spiritual laws against it? Are there conditions and obstacles that they haven't been able to overcome yet? It could be all of those.
It could be. And I think that the fact that a lot of us are becoming aware of this now also makes us a lot stronger as well, to be able to identify these forces and perhaps, you know, become even stronger, you know, connect directly to the divine forces that protect us.
And here we get back to that question of sovereignty.
Yep.
Where is our sense of sovereignty? I find it no accident that Hollywood these days is pumping out apocalypse movies right and left. And I think some of that is a reflection of our collective mindset. You know, we've been in economic and political turmoil for a while, and especially the economic crash has really put a lot of people into, you know, their lives are in disarray. You know, they can't hang on to their jobs, their families, their homes. You know, and politics have gotten to be crazy. And so I think collectively we almost want these apocalyptic scenarios to wipe the slate clean so we can start over again, even if it's wreckage.
Yep.
But on the other hand, are these, is this consciousness presaging some sort of impending apocalypse? I'm not an apocalyptic person. I'm not a doomsayer. I've never really given myself over to conspiracy theories. I don't like doomsday thinking. But we get back to that word disturbing. And these disturbing connections that are falling into place from a lot of different areas, they're coming together in a picture that's not very pleasant.
If I may say something about all of that, you know, I've read a lot of material from the Celtic tradition. I've read all the stories, the folklore, William Butler Yeats, William Blake, and all of the, a lot of, you know, famous and popular Celtic lore mythologists. And one thing I've learned from reading a lot of that material is that they are basing all of their stories on a degree of truth. And I don't find that they like to make things up. They're not just using their imagination to do things like they do in Disney today, making up Hollywood cartoons. I don't. They have a kind of integrity
In sticking to the story, the bardic tradition of sticking to the story in its most truthful way. And they talk a lot about the she, pronounced S-H-E-E is how it's pronounced, but it is spelled S-I-D-H-E. And this is Irish spelling. It never sounds, you know, the way it's spelled. So the she are the fairy people, the elementals, but we're not talking about the pretty little butterfly, you know, winged creatures that we see in Victorian depictions. We are talking about a race of beings that literally lived on this planet, and they looked like humans, and they had abilities. And these people were attacked by some race of beings that came in. I forget what that race was. And this other race was very violent, and they wanted to take over, and they were aggressive. And the she people found over time that even though that they engaged with them by fighting, they were driven underground. They were forced to go underground and allow these other beings to have the surface of the planet, and so they went underground. But I think that if there was a degree of cooperation, that there could be a sharing of the space without antagonizing the others, that we could live peacefully. And some of these people that they talk about in the Celtic lore traditions, they're very powerful people as well, but they just were no match against the aggressive ones that came in. But what I'm seeing now is that with all of the species that we're discovering that are manipulating with humanity and, you know, pestering us in the most negative way, I can understand how some of that can be done when your own existence is completely neglected or annihilated and has forced you to go underground. So I have some sympathy for the she people in the Celtic traditions, and it makes me think that these djinn have some degree of right to be here. If we could live in some kind of cooperation, I'm not saying I want to make friends with all, no, I'm not saying that, but if there was some kind of cooperation, because humanity simply does not recognize any other species outside of themselves, and I find this completely arrogant and annoying myself, and I would like to hit a few people over the head myself with a 2x4, all right? So that would make me one of these djinn, right? But there are different species that live within this planet, on this planet, within the dimensions of this planet, and I think it would be best if we could all share this space. It is not simply one-dimensional the way most humans think it is. It is multidimensional. It always has been. There are other species, and I think that there is a possibility that if we stop neglecting all of these other species and thinking that we're at the top of the food chain, that we could actually live in harmony to some degree.
Well, maybe we'll make you the ambassador. How's that? You can go and you know, bring that point up with the djinn.
Well, the thing is, I feel like I'm part of both. I personally feel like I'm part of both. Like, I have one foot in the world of the she and one foot in the world of humanity. And I absolutely see both sides equally. You know, I mean, granted, what we're talking about here with Rosemary, we're talking about a really hostile group of people and tricksters, and some of them are not hostile. They just want to cut deals and just play or engage with people for whatever their reasons are. But humanity needs to recognize that there are other beings. Some of them do have a right to be here, and we need to learn how to work with them.
I agree with all of that. And, you know, I think in the past, there were more distinct boundaries, even though we read, the ancient tales and even tales from a few centuries ago, and it seems like more people were perceptive of these worlds. But I think the boundaries were clearer. And certainly with regard to the fairies, our Celtic ancestors understood very well how things worked with them and where the boundaries were land-wise and lifestyle-wise. And they had a great deal of respect for the fairies. By the way, I think that it's very hard to separate the djinn and the fairies. And I'm here, like you, Serena, I'm not talking about the little butterfly things. I think those are almost a separate type of entity that got lumped into fairies. But the fairies, who are powerful beings and who were displaced, have so many similarities to the djinn in terms of their stories and their abilities and their relationships with people that it's difficult to pull one from the other, and it just may be different labels for the same entity. In fact, in Middle Eastern lore, the fairies are a type of djinn. So I think sometimes we have different labels for these different entities who may be like different ethnic races on the planet, you know?
Yes, they may be like cousins or something, you know?
Human beings are not uniform. We have different ethnic origins, different physiological characteristics, racial characteristics, and it's probably that way in the spirit world as well, or the entity world, as I should say. But these boundaries, yes, we're coming into more and more contact, and we have this attitude, especially in the West, that we're entitled to do whatever we want. We can go anywhere on the planet and knock down the vegetation and put up our houses. And if we've squatted on somebody's territory, that's their problem. And some of these squatters or victims of squatters are fighting back. And they're saying, hey, this is my place.
Mm-hmm.
Or it's my place too.
Right. It's already occupied. Yeah, I think it's very arrogant to go into another person's territory that is already occupied and decide you want to claim it. I think, really, this is the height of arrogance, and I don't blame them for not having tolerance in some ways.
Oh, I have cases where the resident entity has spoken up and, said, I don't like you here. I was here a long time before you were, and I don't like what you're doing here, and I want you to get out. And in many cases, I think it's the others, the other beings who wind up getting out. They just keep receding the way the she kept receding.
Yeah.
I find it very interesting that we have so many stories going back to ancient times around the world of powerful beings who are inside the earth, mm-hmm. under the surface.
Yep.
And is that where we push them all?
Good point.
And there's the reptilians, there are ant people, snake people, the whole hollow earth theory, ETs who have underground bases, the djinn are underground, the fairies are underground. And why are they there? Is that their natural abode and they have shared the surface with us, or did we gradually push them all into that interdimensional space?
Yeah, and that's the same as what happens with the subconscious. Didn't we take all of those creatures and submerge them into the subconscious where we never think about them until we enter the dream time?
That's right. And, one comment you made about the bardic tradition, I have always felt similar to that the stories that have been told in our mythologies and folklore all have a basis in fact and genuine human experience.
Mm-hmm.
They're not just spun out of people's heads.
Right.
That this is the way we've related to reality. And of course, stories get embellished over time. I think there is some of that. But we can't dismiss these stories as fanciful tales that have no bearing to life in the real world, so to speak. They're part of our interdimensional underpinning, relating to our entire existence in this place.
Yes.
Yeah.
And everybody knows somebody who has had experience like this.
Yep. Yep.
Whether it's benign or a one-off or something that's troubling, what I'm not able to ascertain at this point is how much of our the spectrum of our entity contact experience is negative, in actuality. Or is it just skewed toward the negative because that's what people tend to report more? There are all kinds of benevolent experiences with helpful beings, and we certainly see that in the what we call the fairy kingdom as well. where we have beings who are interested, beings who are tied to the natural landscape, who are willing and interested in having some sort of harmonious relationship with human beings, for those who make the effort to seek them out.
Of course.
Right. Yes. It's based on mutual respect. They're both living here. Why not live, you know, in peace, right?
We're going to have to come to terms with that more and more. One of the things that we've really got to get a better handle on are these invasive activities where the entities are predatory and hostile and manipulative. I believe those sorts of things have been going on since ancient times as well, and whether or not they're reaching a peak or they've taken a new turn, it's hard to say, because a lot of this stuff is just recently coming to the surface. And when I say recently, I'm talking about since about the mid-20th century. It's really been the whole ET scenario which has helped to bring a lot of this to the surface. And but it's only one facet of our engagement with otherworldly beings.
Yeah, especially when you say in your research you've discovered that these shadow men are, you find, usually precede an ET abduction story.
They seem to have been in the landscape for a very long time, because there are Native American stories about tall, dark beings in coats and hats that are out in the landscape, like they're watching or being sentries. I've even related earlier accounts of the proverbial phantom monk to shadow people, because it's that dark figure which in those times usually wore a cowl or a hood, and was described as a phantom monk because that's what the clothing resembled. But they were often seen in areas where there hadn't been any monasteries. Why would a monk be there? they're probably referring to a shadow person.
Rosemary, do you think that there is a possibility that there may be some kind of negative influence or some kind of force that is influencing those experiences that are negative? In other words, you know, there's positive, perhaps some positive experiences with djinn, and then there's the negative experiences, the ones that are animating the negative experiences. Do you feel that there's something maybe beyond them that's controlling those?
I've wondered that myself, and I have no clues at the moment. You know, we're all looking for the Oz behind the curtain.
Right.
And some people would say, all of these things are interconnected. And some would say, hey, the djinn are it. The djinn are the Oz behind the curtain. Well, I think that they're an Oz behind the curtain.
Mm-hmm.
They account for a lot of our experiences. We can trace them back to the djinn over and over again. Someone once asked me, is it that all these other entities have djinn-like characteristics? Why does that mean they're djinn? Well, if it walks like a djinn, talks like a djinn, it's a djinn. All these entities have djinn characteristics,
yeah,
because they probably are djinn. Can we prove it? No. We're looking for patterns and associations that make a picture to us that makes sense. Is there something behind the djinn? That's an even scarier thought.
Uh-huh.
And John Keel addressed that in some of his writing. You know, Keel was very much ahead of his time in his concepts of interdimensional realities and portals and trickster-like beings. Some of the early ufologists got into that. I mean, Vallée is still around, and
mm-hmm.
Some of his work evolved in that direction. But Keel's opinion was there's some cosmic trickster that we don't understand who is manipulating all of this, and we seem to be at its disposal, beck and call and mercy, and that we may never know what it is or why, but it makes us turn into like dogs chasing our tails. We keep looking for answers, and just as we think we get there, it goes up in smoke. And this is very characteristic of the whole trickster phenomenon to begin with. You know, every time we think we've gotten close to an answer on the ET thing. There's going to be disclosure or whatever. We're not going to have disclosure. There's not going to be any big grand announcement. We're just going to, I think, either gradually come into that awareness or consciousness, or something is going to be visited upon us in a dramatic way, but there's not going to be government people coming out and making statements.
Which leads to a really good question. What is the connection between the djinn and the governments of the world?
I have been told by some of the people that I have interviewed, and also some of the sources I have consulted, that governments around the world are aware of these beings, whether you call them ETs or djinn or archons or reptilians or something else, that there are official knowledge and awarenesses of these entities. And of course, this fits into the conspiracy theories as well, that there's collusion, collaboration. And I've been told that by a variety of sources. It's not out of the realm of possibility. I mean, it would make sense to me that if we have all this subjective evidence, and these experiences, they are subjective, all this subjective evidence pointing to the existence of certain kinds of beings who have the capability of interfering with us and demolishing us if they wanted to, it would make sense that government agencies would be immediately interested in getting a handle on this, and unfortunately maybe even collaborating or co-opting with manipulative entities for their own purposes as well. I have no first-hand knowledge of this. I think these are scenarios worth pursuing. Mm-hmm. That's about the best I can put it right now.
And do you have any other questions along those lines, Serena? Because I know that that's one of the questions you asked, that, you know, at some point, what's behind the the people that are in what we call shadow government, if you want to, you know, use conspiracy theory terminology.
What is interesting is that when we were doing an interview with someone, and we were talking about the djinns and our investigations for inquiry or research into what the djinn are, and I'm coming to my own conclusions based on this research myself. And I was telling you that I was listening to Miles Johnston, which Rosemary would know because she's been interviewed by him as well. He was talking about how he was in an interview with someone over Skype, and as soon as the man he was interviewing spoke about the djinn and government, or djinn in Washington, their Skype connection broke down. And then it happened with you and me, Ari.
Yeah.
And, we were talking, and I said something about my suspicions of the djinn operating within the White House. My Skype connection immediately broke down.
Yeah.
And I found that interesting. And some people talk about the effect that the djinn have with electronics and such equipment, electronics, computers, cell phones, anything run by electricity, which do tend to break down in my presence. My housemate can get them to work, but I tend to break them down, and then I have to step back and walk away. The lawnmower, it won't work, it won't start off if I'm standing there. I have to go into the house and then it'll start off. I mean, it's a lot of stuff, but I'm not saying I'm the djinn, I'm just saying there's something funky going on, but that they have affinity or an easy way to manipulate electronic equipment, but that a lot of people, to get back to the Washington point, are suspecting that they are the ones who are running all politics and all political figures who are decision makers. I mean, it's starting to look like that is the presiding force, along with, you know, aliens and ETs, and, you know, just to put add interest to the mix, I guess.
It's an area that I touched upon in the Djinn Connection, but I didn't go into it in detail because it takes off in a whole different direction, and it does get very deep and complex.
And sticky.
And very sticky, yes. And in fact, Miles was the one who told me about the scuttlers. And
yeah.
In the Djinn Connection, I talk about, I interviewed him on some of his experiences about that. So how deep it goes, I'm not certain. And this is an angle in my research that at the moment, at least, I'm not pursuing because I'm still involved in more personal cases, like how are we being affected personally.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the subject. The book that I'm putting the finishing touches on now is on the interdimensional portals and the way we're being affected in our personal environments by these sorts of encounters.
So why do you think that this is on the increase? You mentioned earlier that you're seeing an increase in these events. And why do you think that is?
I believe that these boundaries are more permeable than they used to be, and there's various factors for that. I think the pervasiveness of our internet, global communications, and mass media has something to do with that because it's changing the nature of our interconnectivity, literally. And there could be some environmental factors that have contributed to the erosion of these boundaries, a bombardment with all of these microwaves, for example, and EMF. Some natural cyclical shifts in the planet that could be happening. You know, the planet has its own cycles as well. And our awareness has shifted too. And the fact, it's that old saying, how are you going to keep them down on the farm after they've seen Paris? Once you're aware of something, it's in your radar.
Yeah.
And you're going to notice more things like it. And it's a two-way street because those beings who are aware of us and who are attracted to various individuals for various reasons, they're going to know that too. Just by virtue of me doing this research, I have landed on the radar of all kinds of beings.
Yep.
I'm never going to get off of it. It's, once the door is open, it's open.
Yeah.
And I think that's what's happening to us collectively, is that we're aware of more of these things around us, and so more of those things are going to be apparent to us.
Now, doesn't that show, Rosemary, that they're watching us? Because as you began your research and you delved into it, you became noticeable to them. So that means they must be watching, right?
Oh, yes, I believe they are. I believe that, who knows, all of us could be watched in some way. Some of us seem to, the people who have the experiences seem to be especially watched and interacted with, but some of these cases of what earlier I called the drive-by demons sort of thing, the opportunistics, people could just be under occasional surveillance or, just sort of come up for a check, so to speak. So I think there are different levels of it. And it all comes back to the question of who created us and who's manipulating and managing us from what point and for what purpose. And we get back to this scenario of the Matrix again, that is everything that's in our reality, is it a Matrix-like reality? Most people would be very unsettled to think that we are in some sort of artificially created and managed existence. But it's not out of the realm of possibility.
Yeah. What is your personal opinion on that?
My personal opinion is I still believe in autonomy, the autonomy of the soul. I believe in reincarnation, and I believe that we are not limited to human lives, that the journey of the soul embodies and involves experiencing many life forms, not only on this planet, but in other realms as well. And that's the subject of another book I'm working on
awesome.
Past lives in non-human forms, or what really should be called parallel lives, mm-hmm. because they're really parallel to what we're doing. And that there is a divine energy or presence that holds this cosmic thing together. And that the unifying energy of everything is unconditional love. All of our mystical traditions speak to that and wind up in the same place. So I think that that is above and beyond the scope of what's happening here in this fishbowl of Earth.
Right.
And is this part of our cosmic education? Because I personally, I cannot accept the idea that it's the Matrix and nothing but the Matrix.
Right.
That there's oblivion beyond that. I see this as a piece of a greater scheme in things. And this is part of our call to awareness as well, that we have to lift up our consciousness to the highest possible awareness we can to see a bigger and bigger picture. It doesn't negate the importance of what we're doing here or make it insignificant by any means. But that's what I do believe in, that there is an integrity to the soul, to this essence we call the soul, mm-hmm. which these other beings share as well, as part of the cosmic whole.
Yeah. And with just following in that train of thought, what do you feel, so that I can, you know, so that our audience can understand why Serena and I and yourself and so many others are delving into this subject matter? Because it's a very gruesome, sometimes very heavy, not totally feel good type of subject matter. Why do you do it?
I certainly didn't go looking for it. You know, when I started out in the paranormal, I was fascinated by all things. And throughout my entire career, I have worked both sides of the fence, the light and the dark. And I think one of the best ways of answering that is in an experience that I had very early in my career. I was writing my first book on angels, and I was interviewing experiencers, and I asked a healer, a woman who worked with archangel energy, for an interview. And she said to me very disdainfully, "How can you call yourself a servant of the light when you write books on witchcraft, vampires, and sorcery?"
Wow.
And I said, "How can I be of any use to the light if I don't know what the dark side is doing?"
Amen.
And she had no answer to that, and I did not interview her because I did not consider her to have a very enlightened perspective on all this. But that's where a lot of people are. We're mm-hmm. black and white. It's yeah. either good or it's bad. If it's bad, we don't want it. But the only way we're going to heal that dark underbelly and make really strong advances into the enlightened side of things is by going into that darkness and discovering it and mastering it. And I think that's why I got pulled in this direction. I was quite happy writing about angels and lovely experiences and healing, and mm-hmm. and I still do. That's a part of what I do. But most people don't even want to go into this other Mm-mm. side because it's scary.
Very.
And, you know, I'm mystified also by people who say, "Well, if I don't think about it, it's not going to be there." But that's the way we are.
Oh,
you know?
Yeah.
I'm amazed by the Wiccans that I meet who disavow the existence of the demonic. You know, it's, no, demons don't exist to us. Well, that to me is like, you know, you're ignoring half the picture here. And if you're going to embrace spirituality, all spiritual traditions have to grapple with the dark side, the problem side of things.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think, if I may clarify something, I think what you're saying, Rosemary, is that we have to look at everything if we're going to understand what it is. And spirituality is both good and bad, right?
But it's not when you tell people that there is this dark side or this, you know, the existence of evil spirits, and we have to look at it, they're hearing that by looking at it, we embrace it or invite it or accept it and say, come on in and take a seat, you know, kind of thing. That's not what we're saying. We're saying if we're going to get a handle on what spirituality is and everything that is going on, which is, you know, both good and bad stuff, then we have to look at both of it. We can't just see, because I was doing the angels thing as well, going on, you know, just looking at angels and how beautiful, but I was not having any angel experiences whatsoever. And I was having this other experience, and I was gravitating toward the angel experience because I was desperate for it, but that was not what was happening. And so I was forced into it, like you, like a lot of people. We didn't go looking to learn about this dark side. We were kind of forced into it because as a genuine researcher, you have to investigate what is happening, what is there. Even if it's not pretty, you have to investigate it if you truly want to understand it.
Very well said, and I definitely agree with that. Also, I think another thing that's happening as to why so many people are being pulled in this direction is there may be something going on in our collective consciousness where we are realizing on some level of awareness that this is what we must do in order to heal some things in our societies, and also within humanity and within the individual as well. So we're probably getting a group calling here.
Yep.
And things are manifesting that are propelling us to examine these areas. So I think it's all very good, actually.
Yeah, I do too.
Some of it is frightening and disturbing, as we've talked about, but the good side of it is the potential for the healing to come out of it, that we're going to be better and stronger because we've done this examination.
I so agree with that. And
wiser.
Yeah, much stronger, absolutely. I was wondering, Rosemary, cause, for the time that we have left, if you could make a distinction, if you can, between what is a demon versus a djinn?
It's often hard to make that distinction.
Okay.
I think that a lot of demonic cases really are djinn cases. This would be one of the favorite ways that a tormenting djinn could act out against someone, because both of them are capable of oppression, influence, and possession,
mm-hmm.
and they're deal makers too.
Yeah.
But in terms of Western context of things, because Westerners have a very different idea of demons than other cultures, we consider demons to be servants of Satan, and that it's an all-out battle of good versus evil for the state of the soul. The demonic world that most of the rest of the world recognizes is far more ambiguous. And that it is comprised of various kinds of interfering entities that do everything from play pranks to destroy your marriage to, you know, try to take your soul. And that it's not all orchestrated by a single architect of evil, so to speak. So in our culture, when we talk about demonic cases, of that type, they fall into a progression where an individual, for various reasons, becomes a target, sometimes by invitation. They said that you have to invite them in, but it could be unconscious. The cases that can't be explained very well that way, religion says, well, you know, they just decided to sacrifice themselves as an example, which I don't find a very satisfactory explanation.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a progression of deterioration of emotions, thoughts, self-esteem, guilt, a more oppressive, pervasive influence in the life, the health becomes affected, and in the case of physical possession, a complete takeover of the body. And it always has this spiritual context of subversion of the soul. And the djinn seem to be more selfish and self-serving.
Hmm.
They're not serving an architect of evil, so to speak, although I think some are. We can't make, 100% statements.
Sure.
But the engagements that I see with people, they're usually for manipulation and some sort of self-serving purpose. I want to get this from you for my purposes, sort of thing.
Gotcha.
And they're actually much tougher to deal with than the religious demonic cases. Some of those can drag on for years.
Wow, wow. What in your opinion, do you feel would be what humanity needs to do collectively to overcome this, if there's any such thing?
Certainly, the boundaries between religions are obstacles. I don't see those going away anytime soon. It seems that human beings retrench into those whenever challenged. And even though all religions are fundamentally oriented toward the same thing, the dogma that they all preach is very oppressive and manipulative. In fact, if I were the djinn, I would set myself up as a god and start dictating things.
Right.
That's exactly what religion does to many people.
I love that. That is great.
And it may have happened.
Yeah.
I mean, it may have happened in ancient times. We simply don't know. And I don't mean to call the wrath of religious people down on me, because the spiritual side of religions is much different.
Look at where the stories of the djinn come from. Aren't all the religious texts just filled, rife with stories of these djinn?
Well, even you could argue that the demons that Jesus exercised, were they demons or were they djinn? The world that he lived in would have been familiar with the djinn.
Yep.
Regardless of what label you wanted to put on them, they came out of the same broad context and culture. So we probably put different labels on the same things. And of course, if you start bringing these things up with religious people, especially conservative religious people, well, you have a hornet's nest on your hands, because they're just very rigid about seeing things in certain ways. And I think, religion is almost Janus-faced. It's got a light side and a dark side. And the light side is it provides a framework for people to develop their spiritual awareness, and two, foster that connection with the divine, which is very important.
Yeah.
The dark side of it is that religions are filled with rules and regulations and dogma that may not have a whole lot to do with spiritual truths. They're organizational principles to sustain and maintain the existence of a structure, an organization.
Yeah.
And that's a very big problem for humanity in general. I don't know if we'll ever get past this, because collectively we seem to need that sort of thing. We need this religious organization as a component to life in this reality. And the minute one group of reformers breaks off because they think something's too oppressive, all they do is form something else that becomes eventually too rigid and sometimes even oppressive.
Yeah.
It's an ongoing cycle.
Absolutely. And I think more than likely what humanity eventually needs to work on is their direct connection to the divine, and not have to have interpreters and the structure and the gurus and whatnot, which of course those are the ones that are lending themselves to possibly getting compromised by entities and whatnot. So,
I would finish that by saying the other half of that would be to investigate those forces that are definitely influencing your life. If you want a handle on your divinity, if you want a handle on having control of what's happening in your life, then you need to investigate all the forces that are influencing it, even if it's ugly.
Very true. And it is so important to have that spiritual underpinning. That's part of my message to the paranormal community all the time. You must find the source of your spiritual strength, whatever it is for you, and build that foundation, your connection to the divine and to spiritual forces that are greater than you know, life here on Earth. That's very important to our ability to transcend these darker things that we're dealing with.
Absolutely. Well, we've come to the end of our show today. Rosemary, you've been absolutely, it's just, I'm just speechless. It's outstanding the amount of information you've shared with us today. So crucial. I thank you so much for doing that. Again, everyone, I strongly suggest for you to pick up a copy of the Djinn Connection. Absolutely amazing information in there. And also visit Rosemary's site at visionaryliving.com and djinnuniverse.com, and that's spelled D like David, J like Jam, I, N like Nancy, N like Nancy, universe.com. You've all been hearing Shattering the Matrix again. We will be on air next Saturday at 6 p.m. Pacific Standard Time and also at 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And thank you again for joining us on our show. Rosemary, once again, thank you, and hopefully we can have you again.
Thank you, Ari and Serena. It was a pleasure being with you.
Thank you. Good night.
Good night.
You've been listening to Shattering the Matrix with your host, Ari Kopel and Serena. Please visit our website, 2012emergence.com. That's 2012.